following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
Without freedom of the press, no democratic form of government could exist.
We switch you now to London.
I'm standing on a rooftop looking out over London.
Good night and good luck.
Good evening from our CBS newsroom in New York.
NBC presents Chet Huntley and David Brinkley.
From ABC, this is World News Tonight. With Peter Jennings in London, Max Robinson in Chicago, and from our desk in Washington, Frank Reynolds.
Good evening.
This historic legislation, the telecommunications law, will create many, many high wage jobs, will create opportunity and better lives for all Americans.
When the press is free, the people of a country are free. When the press is not free, the people of a country are in danger of slavery.
Keeping you informed with information, news, and the views of people making the news. It's the Nicole Sandler Show on NicoleSandler.com and the Progressive Voices Network.
A suspicious package was also sent to Robert De Niro. No one knows who sent the packages, but De Niro did have a defiant message for the bomber.
I will bring you down, baby. I will bring you down to Chinatown.
Now, De Niro... dressed as the Monopoly Man for some reason. De Niro's not even a government official. He just criticized Trump at award shows. We're getting pretty far down the list of Trump's enemies at this point. Watch your backs. And we're learning more about the bombs themselves. For instance, the explosive device sent to CNN featured a parody ISIS flag with a "Get her done" inscription. Sounds odd, but that flag is a right-wing meme on the internet. Say what you will about the Unabomber, but at least that guy had a manifesto. He wasn't sending his victims the distracted boyfriend. Plus, "Get her done" is Larry the Cable Guy. Come on, if you're going to put a comedian's catchphrase on an explosive device, dynamite is right there. After, we miss you, Jimmy. Still with us? After yesterday's bombs were discovered, Donald Trump held a rally in Wisconsin, and he had a simple message.
Those engaged in the political arena must stop treating political opponents as being morally defective.
So you're deleting your Twitter account?
Yeah.
Throughout his speech, Trump kept reminding the audience how civil he was being.
The Democrats are for higher taxes, more regulation, and more top-down government control. And by the way, do you see how nice I'm behaving tonight? This is like, have you ever seen this?
Yes. I used to see presidents do it all the time before we elected a guy who's more afraid of Jake Tapper than Kim Jong-un. And we miss you, Jake.
Just laying it all out there.
Then Trump singled out who he believes is responsible for all the incivility in America.
As part of a larger national effort to bridge our divides and bring people together, the media also has a responsibility to set a civil tone and to stop the endless hostility and constant negative and oftentimes false attacks and stories.
It's all the media's fault. Things have gotten so bad. In fact, did you see when they reported on me calling Mexican people rapists and criminals? Just the worst. You can't report on the things I say and be nice at the same time.
Of course not. Well, thank you, Stephen Colbert. But there's big news. Welcome to the Friday show. I'm Nicole Sandler here at NicoleSandler.com, the Progressive Voices Network, and a podcast near you. It's been a busy, eventful day. It's so funny because, you know, I do What's News. I produce, write it and produce it and everything early in the morning. And just as I finished, walk out to the living room, turn on the news, and I see, first there was yet another couple of packages allegedly found today. It just kept developing. And then the news that they arrested somebody. Yes, they arrested a guy named Caesar. Hold on, I got it here somewhere. Savick. Caesar Savick of Aventura, Florida. Didn't you just know it was going to be a Florida man? because it is Florida.
Boy, Florida.
I expected nothing different. So just a few minutes ago, actually, it's probably still going on, a press conference at the Department of Justice, and little Jeffrey Sessions, Jefferson Beauregard Sessions, ambled up to the microphone.
So I am pleased to participate in this announcement that a suspect is in the custody of the FBI. I want to remind everyone that the defendant in this case, as in every case, is innocent until proven guilty.
Mm-hmm.
He has been charged today with five federal crimes, including interstate transportation of an explosive, illegal mailing of explosives, threats against former presidents and certain other persons, threatening interstate communications, and assaulting current and former federal officers. For these charges, the defendant faces up to 58 years in prison.
Cool.
These charges may change or expand as the investigation proceeds. This is a law and order administration. We will not tolerate such lawlessness, especially not political violence.
But political violence is exactly what this was. And this guy was arrested here in South Florida, about 20 minutes away from where I live. Boy, it's been an eventful year here in Florida, huh? Anyway, I'll tell you what, we've got a busy show today. It's a Friday. The World Series is underway. You know, and it's funny, I'm not a sports fan, but I got Los Angeles Dodgers versus the Boston Red Sox, two cities that I lived in. But if I had to root for one, I'd probably root for LA because I liked LA better. I did. I lived there for 15 years. Anyway, I am not a sports person, but my husband, you might know, is somebody who's represented professional baseball players as their agent for his entire adult life. There's a new book out about the dark side of baseball called Baseball Cop. And so a little later on, David's going to join me in here to speak with two of the co-authors of this book, because it's really fascinating. And there is an intersection between sports and politics, especially when you start talking about the seedy side of baseball. So we'll do that. Yeah, I know. I see the chat rooms laughing at the law and order administration part of that statement from Sessions. Anyway, so I'll tell you what, let's just start with what's new, since it's a busy day. Obviously, the news has changed since I first recorded the What's News this morning that runs all day on the Progressive Voices Network. So we'll do it live.
I read the news today.
It's time for Nicole Sandler's What's News from NicoleSandler.com and the Progressive Voices Network.
All right. As I told you, a suspect has been identified and arrested in a string of mail bombs sent to critics of Donald Trump. Senior law enforcement officials identified the suspect as 56-year-old Cesar Savick Jr. of Aventura, Florida. Investigators used forensic evidence to trace Sayak to a mail processing facility in Plantation, and he was arrested in a nearby auto zone where some reports said he worked. Video showed his white van covered with photos of Trump and other right-wing paraphernalia, and Twitter users shared photos of the van they shot in recent days in South Florida. All the windows were covered by these stickers. It's nuts. Other stickers showed prominent liberals with bullseyes over them. Haven't we already been through this with Sarah Palin, right? And a sticker that says CNN sucks. Boy, he's original, isn't he? Savick, who's originally from New Jersey, has a lengthy criminal record dating back at least 20 years, including arrests for terrorist threats against judges. Go figure. Public records show Savick is a registered Republican who appears to have owned a dry cleaning business and a catering business at some points. Donald Trump announced the arrest at an unrelated event in the White House. It was a meeting. It was the Young Black Leadership Summit where this happened.
I am pleased to inform you that law enforcement has apprehended the suspect and taken him into custody. It's an incredible job by law enforcement. We've carried out a far-reaching federal, state, and local investigation to find the person or persons responsible for these events. These terrorizing acts are despicable and have no place in our country.
No place.
All right, you know what? Enough of him. He gives me the creeps, as he should any thinking, breathing human being. So later on at this event, of course, Trump made his scripted remarks. And then, of course, he starts going off about globalism and, you know, so much for political niceties. So this happened.
Every citizen benefits when we stop foreign countries from cheating our workers. That's what they've been doing, you know. They're called globalists. They like
buzzword
they like
for Jews.
The globe. I like the globe, too.
And
I like the globe,
somebody
too,
but yelled
we have
out
to take
Soros.
Care of our people. We have to. Globalists.
Oh, it's so funny, Trump. So somebody in the room there shouts out, Soros. And then he says, lock him up, and Trump laughs. And you wonder why we have some a Trump follower sending out bomb threats or bombs. all right. So that's all the Trump I'm going to play for you today. Don't worry. Let me tell you what else is going on. So that was after Trump took to Twitter this morning to complain about Twitter removing bots that were following him and about all of the, as he put it, quote, bomb stuff slowing his alleged campaign momentum. He didn't tweet about the fact that some crazy person is sending out bombs to his political opponents, political critics, but he bitched about Twitter taking away some of his followers. They were fake. He's so quick to call out fake news, but he doesn't admit that he's got most of his Twitter followers are fake. They're bots. I lost about, I don't know, a few hundred Twitter followers because they were bots. And then he complains about the bomb stuff.
Asshole.
Thank you, Keith. I needed to get that out. Anyway, there is other Trump news today. Trump is weighing an executive order to close the southern border to migrants, including asylum seekers, as part of a push to rally supporters. Sources say the details are still being worked out, but if Trump goes ahead with it, he will invoke the same part of immigration law used in last year's travel ban to bar foreigners from entering the U.S. on national security grounds. Three sources cited in the report said Trump may issue a proclamation on the executive action on Tuesday, a week before the midterm elections. Boy, that's not pandering for votes or anything, is it? Reports of the plan came shortly after Trump declared on Twitter that he was, quote, bringing out the military to deal with a migrant caravan headed for the U.S. border, which he described as a national emergency. By the way, people who are watching this caravan say it's at least a month away. Trump wants it to get here by election day to, you know, give him more votes. Anyway, Homeland Security Secretary Kirstjen Nielsen yesterday spoke with Fox so-called News.
Is there any scenario under which if people force their way across the border, they could be shot at?
We do not have any intention right now to shoot at people. They will be apprehended, however. But I also take my officer and agent, their own personal safety extraordinarily seriously. They do have the ability, of course, to defend themselves.
So if shot at, they would shoot back.
No, I think we'd have to work through that. But I want to make it very clear we will absolutely not tolerate violence against Border Patrol in this situation.
All right. So Kirstjen Nielsen, I just want to make sure you heard that. She qualified the statement. We have no intention right now of shooting people. In case you missed it, here's again that part.
We do not have any intention right now to shoot at people.
But that may change because we're gun happy. Yeah, because we like shooting them immigrants, them illegal aliens. Sorry, just frustrating. For some reason, Nielsen went on Fox yesterday to talk about the caravan as the investigation into, at the time, 10 pipe bombs sent to prominent Trump critics was ongoing. Can you say priorities are fucked up? In other news, Megyn Kelly is out at NBC's Today Show. As NBC announced today that other Today anchors will replace her in the 9 a.m. hour, bringing an end to Megyn Kelly Today. Yeah, that deserves some applause. Following months of missteps, awkward moments, and a racially insensitive defense of blackface Halloween costumes. This is the same idiotic woman who insisted that Santa Claus and Jesus Christ are white. With just over a week left until Election Day, Republicans are changing their message on Obamacare. Suddenly, they seem to be touting its most important feature, covering pre-existing conditions. Funny how that works, right? A Phoenix TV station called out senatorial candidate Martha McSally for the blatant for her blatant hypocrisy.
Republican Senate candidate Martha McSally is now claiming that she is fighting to protect people with pre-existing conditions.
But does that match up with McSally's record in Congress? Our political editor Dennis Welch looked at her record.
Dennis, can we please talk about the things that matter to most voters instead of repeating the Arizona Democrat Party press releases?
Less than 2 weeks left in this election, and Martha McSally clearly showing her frustration.
It's ridiculous, honestly. Do you have anything to talk about, like the caravan?
The reason reporters were asking Republican Congresswoman Martha McSally about health care in that instance, which frustrated her to no end, is because her latest ad says she's leading the fight to force insurance companies to cover pre-existing conditions, which is amazing. So, of course, reporters are asking her about it.
Of course.
This is happening all over the country. Obamacare, you may recall, is what forced insurance companies to guarantee coverage for people who have pre-existing conditions. Because of Obamacare, that's why insurance companies now can't turn you down for coverage because you've got a pre-existing condition. And they can't charge you more money if you've got a pre-existing condition. That's what Obamacare did. Republicans in Congress have voted at least 70 times
70.
To kill that.
Yeah.
The top Senate Republican, Mitch McConnell, says, yeah, in the Senate, they'll do it again if Republicans are able to hold on to the Senate. 20 Republican-led states right now are suing to kill Obamacare, including specifically that part that makes insurance cover pre-existing conditions.
Yep.
That lawsuit is supported overtly by the Trump administration. And to put the icing on all of it, the Trump administration just 3 days ago unilaterally changed the rules set by Obamacare so that now insurance companies will be allowed to turn you down if you have a pre-existing condition. Or they'll be allowed to charge you more because of it. Literally just this week, the Trump administration took that action so that people with pre-existing conditions will no longer be protected. What they've decided to do is just lie about it. The president is doing it with tweets like this. Republicans will totally protect people with pre-existing conditions. Democrats will not.
Yeah, and if you want to believe Trump, I've got some swampy land not too far from here I can sell you. In the latest example of today in GOP voter suppression news, Rachel Maddow takes us to Dodge City, Kansas.
This year, they've decided to move that one single polling place for 13,000 voters in majority Hispanic Dodge City, Kansas. They've decided to move the one polling location for 13,000 voters completely outside the city limits. Now it turns out that getting to Dodge City's one out-of-town single polling place for 13,000 voters is going to be even harder because the elections office has been sending people to the wrong address.
Nice.
Not kidding. The AP reports tonight that local officials sent newly registered voters an official registration notice telling them to vote at an old polling place that is no longer being used in Dodge City. The chairman of the local Democratic Party saying tonight, quote, "I didn't know this could get worse." But it did. Supposedly, officials are sending a new notice to voters with the correct information now. The Kansas Secretary of State is responsible for running elections in that state. His name is Chris Kobach. He's the Republican candidate for governor in this year's elections, which means if any of the majority Hispanic voters in Dodge City ever do get to see a ballot this year or cast one, Chris Kobach will be right at the top of the ticket in this election that's being run in the state by his office.
So dirty tricks are being played all over the place. All I can tell you is Election Day is a week from Tuesday. It is the most important thing that you get out and vote. All right, we're going to take a break. We'll check in with Brad and Desi in the Green News Report. We'll come back with my husband, David, and we'll talk with a couple of the co-authors of the new book, Baseball Cop, The Dark Side of America's National Pastime. Yeah, we'll talk baseball. It's Friday, and I'm just sick of Trump. So, you know, they caught the bomber. I was going to say the Unabomber. They caught the letter bomber. I guess it's time for some baseball. Don't go away. We'll be right back.
180 mile per hour winds.
Category 5 super typhoon Yutu slams into Mariana Islands and other U.S. territories as the 2018 hurricane season is now the most powerful ever recorded.
Could open ExxonMobil up to further lawsuit.
New York State sues ExxonMobil for defrauding investors about climate change. Plus,
we are the first generation that has known how to fix this problem, but we are the last generation that will actually be able to do something about it.
Canada places a price on pollution with a national carbon tax.
All of those really big stories and more straight ahead. From BradBlog.com, I'm Brad Friedman.
And I'm Desi Doyen.
Stand by for 6 minutes of independent green news, politics, analysis, and snarky comment.
That is true. There are scientists on both sides. On one side, all the scientists. On the other, one guy who runs a blog called Real True American Science Eagle.Jesus.
This is your Green News Report.
Forecast rapture.
Okay, Desi Doyen, I think you got about 3 or 4 top stories to fit into today's report, so I'll just shut up.
Okay. Well, up first, Hurricane Willa made landfall on Mexico's Pacific coast as a powerful Category 3 on Tuesday, and then Super Typhoon Yutu, one of the strongest cyclones in history, rapidly intensified into a Category 5 before slamming into the U.S. territory Mariana Islands on Wednesday.
With gusts up to 220 miles per hour.
Yes, it was the strongest typhoon to pass near the U.S. territories of Saipan and Tinian. Now, if it seems to you like we've had more major hurricanes than usual this year, you are right. In 2018, both the Atlantic and Pacific hurricane seasons are the most powerful ever recorded in the Accumulated Cyclone Energy Index, which measures the combined intensity and duration of all tropical storms and hurricanes that form in any given year. 2018 shattered the previous record set in 1992. One of those storms, Category 4 Hurricane Wallaka, has obliterated a tiny island in the Hawaiian archipelago. Federal scientists confirmed this week that Wallaka washed away 11-acre East Island this month, which was a critical habitat for endangered Hawaiian monk seals, sea turtles, and birds. Scientists called its loss a huge blow to conservation efforts.
Unfortunately, it's not the last of the islands that are likely to disappear.
Meanwhile, the U.S. Supreme Court this week handed a temporary victory to the Trump administration, issuing a temporary administrative stay on a landmark climate liability lawsuit brought by 21 young people against the federal government. In the lawsuit, 21 young people aged 22 and younger allege that the federal government has violated their constitutional rights by failing to act on man-made climate change and protect their life, liberty, and property, since they and all of today's children will be forced to deal with the consequences of climate change for the rest of their lives. The trial had been scheduled to begin on Monday, and it's unclear if it will be allowed to proceed. But there is some good news. New York State Attorney General Barbara Underwood on Wednesday filed a lawsuit against oil giant ExxonMobil for deceiving investors by downplaying the expected financial risks of climate change.
Well, what took you so long?
The suit alleges that Exxon defrauded shareholders, deceiving them into believing the company was managing the risk that stricter emissions regulations might pose to its bottom line. In reality, Underwood says, it was, quote, intentionally and systematically underestimating or ignoring those risks.
So they pretended first that climate change didn't exist, then they pretended that they got it taken care of, and the whole time they were lying to investors about all of it.
Exactly. The Center for International Environmental Law called the suit, quote, a wake-up call for investors who continue to bet on fossil fuels, and pretends a new wave of climate litigation.
This could cost ExxonMobil hundreds of millions of dollars, even billions of dollars, unless the Supreme Court kills it all.
Finally, Canadian Prime Minister Justin Trudeau this week announced that his administration will implement a national carbon tax beginning next year to put a price on the pollution that causes dangerous global warming.
It is free to pollute, so we have too much pollution.
In a press conference, Trudeau listed the multiple billion-dollar extreme weather events, wildfires, and floods hitting Canada in recent years, and called action on climate change a moral and economic imperative. And also,
it is common sense that if you put a price on something you don't want, pollution, people will pollute less. And if there are costs associated for average families, we will more than compensate those families for those costs.
Trudeau's new climate action incentive plan will return all carbon tax revenue directly to households to support families in making the transition away from fossil fuels. He says most families will get back more than they pay in higher energy costs.
First pot for the entire country and now a carbon tax. I am moving to Canada. For much more on all of these stories and the ones we couldn't get to today, please check out our website at greennews.bradblog.com. I'm Brad Friedman.
And I'm Desi Doyen.
And this has been your Green News Report.
Take off. Take off to the great white north. Take off. It's a beauty way to go. Take off.
This is a huge, huge issue.
And we're talking about it. The Nicole Sandler Show on Progressive Voices and NicoleSandler.com.
All right, we're back, and we've got a different shot set up here because there's two of us in the studio. Listeners, meet David. David Sloane, my husband. David, say hi to the listeners.
Hi, listeners. How you doing?
They can't talk back to you. You're not going to hear them.
I understand.
Okay. All right. So I asked David to come in here today to join us because we're going to talk a little bit about baseball. As I mentioned earlier, there's a new book out called Baseball Cop, The Dark Side of America's National Pastime. And it's written by Eddie Dominguez with Christian Red and Teri Thompson. Now, you know Christian Red.
Correct.
But, well, not because he wrote a story about you, but he did write a recent story in the New York Daily News about something that we've been dealing with for the last few years here, that I will put a link to that story, the New York Daily News we're talking about, on my blog along with today's podcast at NicoleSandler.com, should you care to to read it, because it would be too long to go into detail about it now.
Correct. But first, I want to thank you for doing this. I first met Christian Red back in, I believe it was 2004, when he crashed the wedding of my client, Carlos Delgado, in Puerto Rico. And Carlos wasn't thrilled with it, but I pretty much impressed on him, hey, this is no big deal. Don't let it ruin your wedding day. And that was the beginning of my relationship with Christian. As you say, he was kind enough to do a extensive piece in the New York Daily News about the shitstorm that I have been involved in for the last, 3 years almost, mm-hmm. with the state of Tennessee, because I had a piece of garbage as a client who stabbed me in the back. But putting that to the side for the moment, again, thank you for allowing me to, in a small way, repay his kindness by giving the book that he's involved with some exposure here. Christian is a great writer. I followed him even before he crashed Carlos's wedding. But nonetheless, he has done a lot of really fine work and recently was covering the trial that took place for the past couple of weeks in New York City, wherein several people involved in the shoe business who were caught up in bribing college athletes in order to get them to attend certain schools to play basketball. They charged several people with crimes, which is highly unusual because most of the time the corruption in professional sports rarely, if ever, gets brought to the surface. And even if it does, the punishment generally amounts to a slap on the wrist. These guys are guilty of serious shit, and there are more people being tried, and Christian was covering that. So that's why this whole segue into this book works, because the government's involved now. They have been involved before, but not in a way that really affected the overall arena of sports, if you will. Now they're getting involved with this, and I'm hoping that it creates a positive change as opposed to some of the things that the government gets involved in, they make worse rather than make better. So with that said, how about getting Christian and Teri on the
line? Let's do it. All right. They're on the line. Christian Red and Teri Thompson are co-authors, along with Eddie Dominguez, of Baseball Cop, The Dark Side of America's National Pastime. Now, I know Christian and Teri work together at the Daily News, and the Daily News has had a few downsizings in recent years. Teri and Christian, hello.
Hello.
All right, we're all here.
Thank you for having us.
Oh, it's my pleasure. Just to let people know, Teri, you were the managing editor of sports at the Daily News until about 3 years ago when the Daily News did their first big round of cutting off heads over there.
Yes, that's right.
And Christian, just we remember it was just a month or so ago that they did it again, and you were let go, and it, along with at least half of the Daily News writing staff, I think.
It was pretty much the bulk of the sports department,
wow.
And there were cuts across the newsroom. But the sports department this July was downsized from 34, I believe, or 35, down to 8 people.
Ouch.
So that's how many people we used to send regularly to Yankees Red Sox games. So you can imagine what a New York sports department in that size has to contend with, covering all these different sports teams, in addition to all the stuff that goes on in New York on a regular basis anyway. So
that's really
I can imagine a daunting. Yeah,
that's really a shame, because there's a lot of that kind of stuff going on at newspapers around the country, where staffs are being cut and newspapers are going out of business, just at a time when we really need real journalism. So that's a shame. But we're here today.
Yeah, well, the other interesting thing is that Teri, before she became the managing editor, started an investigative, really an original new kind of idea, where she started an investigative team within the sports department, and the design was to go and find these interesting stories, whether they be legal or corruption or crime or something outside of the box, rather than the day-to-day beat coverage, which by all means is very important, but this was an interesting concept. And just like you said, with these downsizings at newsrooms across the country, especially at newspapers, those kinds of stories are harder to do. And in most cases with newsrooms, I would think, and Teri can certainly echo or not, the feeling is that there's no time or resources to do them. So that's a big shame too, because there's a lot of maybe under the belly or sinister things that are going on that won't be reported because there aren't the people there to do it.
Wow. Yep.
And from the consumer side, it appears they've not only downsized the personnel, they've downsized the paper. I've been a subscriber to USA for 30-some years, since the paper started.
USA Today.
USA Today, what did I say?
USA.
Sorry, USA Today for 30-some years. At any rate, recently, the paper has devolved to the point where each section is one folded page and one page in the middle for news, sports, business, and their life section. So, and they raised the price for the subscription. I called them up. I said, if this is what we're getting less and you're asking us to pay more, you can keep it. And unfortunately, that's the same route that the local papers have taken as well, but at least they're not as expensive. So we have subscribed to one of them, and it's turned out to be okay. But nonetheless, as I said originally, they're not only downsizing the personnel, they're downsizing the news, and that's unfortunate. But let's jump into the book. First of all, my curiosity was piqued in Eddie's bio.
Eddie Dominguez, whose name is actually, it says by Eddie Dominguez with Christian Red and Teri Thompson. So he's I guess, the lead author on the book?
Well, it's his story. And by that, I mean, and Teri can, again, certainly add her perspective as well. But the thing that intrigued us about Eddie's story was how comprehensive it was. I mean, here's a person that his family fled Castro's Cuba in the 60s with Lyndon Johnson's freedom flights. He came to the U.S. with, as he says in the book, with nothing. I mean, his family, his mom, his brother, his dad, nothing. They landed in Florida. They eventually made their way to Boston. He became a decorated Boston police detective, was in the force for more than 29 years, and had a variety of different roles, but one of those was working with an FBI drug task force. He got involved with baseball starting in 1999 and became a resident security agent, which, for those listeners that don't know, it's basically, again, this is spelled out in the book, but the eyes and the ears of a Major League Baseball team. And he was still working within the Boston Police Department, because resident security agents are law enforcement members who are contracted by baseball to carry out those jobs. But the eyes and ears basically means you're looking out for every security aspect of the team, both at home and in Eddie's case, he often traveled with the team, especially when they went to play in New York against the Yankees. But while he was a resident security agent, of course, there were the congressional hearings first in 2005 and then later in 2008, although that was specifically Roger Clemens and his former trainer, Brian McNamee. But the 2005 hearings really cast the spotlight on baseball and what it was doing to rectify its problems, particularly the performance-enhancing drug issue, which had exploded it by that point.
What?
Eddie was at those
players take performance-enhancing drugs, Christian?
Yeah.
No.
I'm sorry?
Players yeah, take exactly. performance-enhancing
exactly.
drugs? No.
But if listeners, again, aren't familiar with the fallout of those hearings, George Mitchell, the former senator, was appointed by then-Commissioner Bud Selig to compile a report about baseball's doping past, doping history, which he did. It was I can't remember the exact amount of months, maybe Teri will remember, but I think 18 months or so before he released the final product in December of 2007. But one of the recommendations of that report was baseball should develop or implement an investigative unit. And here's the key part, which is, again, spelled out in the book. But in Mitchell's report, he says this unit, if it's formed, should be completely separate and autonomous from the labor side of baseball. Labor's responsibility should be and continue to be maintaining its relationship with the union and all the issues surrounding the collective bargaining agreement. And so Eddie Dominguez was intrigued by that idea, that there would be this autonomous unit. He still had his reservations because he had been asked several times while he was an RSA to be a part of the security force full-time working for baseball, and he was had seen a number of issues, including the PED, the performance-enhancing drug issue, come up, and baseball's turn a blind eye or try and cover it up. And so he was hesitant about joining such a unit. But when it was spelled out that it would be autonomous, and the head of the unit, Dan Mullen, who was a former NYPD, told him, listen, we could do a lot of great things if you come aboard. And so he did. And one of the most enlightening, I think, parts about the book is right at the beginning of the DOI in 2008, when it was established and Eddie Dominguez had joined it, he was told by a baseball executive, literally within the first couple of days of joining the unit, you're not wanted at all. This unit is not, this was only done to appease, Bud Selig because George Mitchell recommended it. But you should know that this unit, nobody in baseball wants you guys digging up or doing this job. And you could imagine what Eddie felt like hearing that within days of joining this unit, where he thought that this would be this great next chapter of his professional career. And that's what he was greeted with. So that's a little bit of, certainly Teri, I've talked a little bit too long, but Teri can definitely.
Well, tell me this.
I'm in.
tell me this.
I think Teri, you're doing a great job.
You are doing a great job, Christian.
Summarizing this book, which is, for both Christian and myself, a real pleasure. To work with Eddie.
Tell me this, because this was one of the things that I was curious about. How did you come across Eddie to begin with? I mean, and let's not leave out, in addition to everything that you just mentioned, the fact that Eddie is a survivor of pancreatic cancer. And the reason that I want to bring that to the attention of the listeners is this show, Nicole and myself, lost a very good friend, just a few months ago, Joel Silberman,
who unfortunately was not able to beat pancreatic cancer. It is a particularly tough, not that any form is good, but particularly tough diagnosis. And for him to have beaten it, he must be quite a person to reckon with. And I was just wondering how it was that you guys had come across him to begin with.
Absolutely.
Well, go ahead, Teri. Yeah. I have to say, we had done a lot of coverage of biogenesis as well as all kinds of reporting throughout the years with our sports investigative team that Christian mentioned, beginning in 2000 and lasting all the way to 2015, which is quite a run, of the issues facing baseball, including performance-enhancing drugs. And so in our reporting, Christian met Eddie. Eddie was never a source for us during our newspaper work. As long as he worked for Major League Baseball, he was not a media-friendly person. Mm-hmm. But Christian managed to, and he has a great bedside manner, he managed to form a friendship with Eddie. And then once Eddie left or was fired from Major League Baseball, basically along with the entire group, then Christian reconnected with him, and the story kind of goes on from there.
I see.
So yeah. So he ran this, was in this investigative unit that was part of MLB? I mean, they were self-policing?
Correct.
That? Yeah. Huh. Well, you know, that always works. I mean, that's what the government does.
Right.
The government investigates themselves, and that always turns out right. Well, right?
So in that case, since this Department of Investigation has wrapped up their investigations, baseball's all clean now, right?
Of course. Of course. And just like it always has been.
And the reward for the end of the biogenesis investigation that Teri was alluding to, and of course, just the nutshell version for the readers, for the listeners, is that Biogenesis was an anti-aging clinic in Florida, in Miami area, and it was run by Anthony Bosch. It became sort of an epicenter for distributing performance-enhancing drugs to professional athletes, primarily in baseball, and it got caught up in both a baseball investigation and then further a federal investigation. And the end result was that Alex Rodriguez, formerly of the Yankees, was the biggest name in the group of players that was suspended ultimately. And, of course, his was the longest. It was a season-long suspension. But after the Biogenesis case ended, at least for baseball, they immediately, within a couple months after A-Rod accepted his ban for the season of 2014, they gutted the DOI, the Department of Investigations, by firing not only Eddie, but his two supervisors and another investigator. And that was, you know, a head-scratcher, for lack of a better word, because here they had carried out this years-long investigation into this clinic and had delivered information that resulted in these suspensions of players, but their reward was, okay, here's your pink slip.
Well, but Christian, now let's be realistic mm-hmm. about this. Don't they know at this point that even without that Department of Investigation, they have the ever-vigilant, bulldog-like investigative capacity that the Major League Baseball Players Association exerts on all of its members, because you and I both know how strongly they clamp down on anybody that commits even the slightest type of offense, correct? I mean, there were only, 13 players that were represented by one agency in this Biogenesis scandal, and the Baseball Players Association looked at that, and they saw no coincidence there whatsoever, so they just let the agents involved off with a reprimand. But, oh my God, the harshness of a reprimand, it has completely devastated their business. I think they've only gotten a couple of hundred clients since then and made a few tens of millions of dollars. So with that type of harsh, vigilant oversight, what do they need a Department of Investigation for?
Right. It's very true. Go ahead, Teri.
I was just going to say, I assume you're saying that facetiously.
You guessed correctly, Teri.
You know, I think... I think one of the most interesting parts of Baseball Cop, in my opinion, is the Department of Investigations, Addie's group's relationship with the DEA. And sort of to your point, David, baseball, Major League Baseball's reaction to that, which was basically to tell the DOI, stop sharing information with the DEA and the investigative people out of the Southern District of Miami with the Department of Justice. They went ahead and indicted several people and who accepted plea agreements for convictions, but it's amazing to me the sort of inside story of how that all came down.
Correct. Well, baseball baseball has a long history with drugs, okay? Before I ever was born, players were taking greenies, which are speed, because you're talking about, in the old days, it was 154-game schedule plus spring training, and they play every day with a few days off, and the wear and tear on their bodies made it, in their minds, impossible to get up for every game. So they got up. And after greenies, the next big scandal in baseball came in the 70s when a bunch of players happened to be using recreational drugs at that point more than performance-enhancing drugs. Then after that, there was the beginning of the performance-enhancing drugs era. And I have a personal story in regard to that. In approximately 2000, the Players Association holds meetings at least a couple times a year with agents so they can make believe they're actually doing something. And during one of those meetings, Don Fear, who was the leader of the Players Association at that point, got up and gave his speech about what the state of the game and the union's involvement in it. And after he got done, there was a break where we could get some sandwiches and stuff. And while everybody else was eating, I approached Don Fear and I said, "Don, I have a client who will remain anonymous, who has told me that he is one of the few players on his team that is not taking steroids. Now, this is something that is going to become very serious if you don't take care of it and take care of it right away." His response to me was, "This is not an issue for the union to deal with." And I said, "Why is that?" And he said, "Because it's a privacy issue." And I said, "This is a union. One of the prime functions of a union is to see to the well-being of its members. There is reams and reams and reams of evidence showing that taking steroids for an extended period of time is very damaging to people's health. So this is a health issue more than a privacy issue, and you need to do something about it." The reaction there was very similar to the scene in Jaws, where Roy Scheider is on the beach telling the mayor that you're not going to do anything until a shark swims up on the beach and bites somebody in the ass. And it was a short while later, Jose Canseco wrote his book about everybody in baseball being on steroids. That morphed into the later investigations that you mentioned, wherein the government once again got involved and put George Mitchell in charge of an investigation. And the result of that investigation was, let's be honest about it, a collective yawn. Nothing really happened. A few players got some shit about it. Somebody lost an endorsement here. A few people got outed for having actually done steroids. But in terms of the actual impact on it, it was very minor. It wasn't really until a couple of years after that they instituted the joint drug agreement or whatever it was. And even that in the beginning was a joke, because they were essentially letting the players know when they were coming to test them. So it wasn't until after Biogenesis that they got a little bit more serious about it and really cracked down. But this is about more than just drugs, because one of the most interesting things to me in Eddie's past, if you will, was what you had mentioned in regard to the barbershop scandal. That, to me, is hilarious, borderline Keystone Cop sort of thing. Can you give us the details on that, please? Because I think everybody will be interested in what happened there.
Sure. Terry, you want to chime in? Or?
Yeah, go ahead.
Well, the one thing that Eddie... one of the things that Eddie encountered when he was the RSA prior to joining the DOI in 2008 was that there was a group of barbershops around the Boston area that eventually Boston PD started looking into, because they had had tips and Eddie had informants and sources telling him that these were
facades for gambling operations, underground gambling operations, in the basement or some back room, whereas you would walk in and not think anything of it because it was a barbershop. But eventually his sources and the investigation and the leads led to one of David Ortiz's inner circle. And the entire episode is detailed in Baseball Cop, but one of the exchanges, maybe, David, that you're referring to is that eventually it came to a head where Eddie, as the RSA, and Dan Hallam, Kevin Hallinan, who was the head of security for MLB at the time. So Kevin Hallinan, Eddie Dominguez, Terry Francona, who was the manager of the Red Sox at the time, and of course Ortiz was on the team, they all met in Francona's office, and it was laid out on the table. This is what we know, David Ortiz. Can you say anything about it? He denied having any kind of connection to this individual and his alleged gambling habits. But no sooner had that meeting taken place than Eddie, after leaving the meeting and going to his next destination, he got a call from his informant saying, "Hey, what happened? The barbershop where this person who was in the entourage of David Ortiz has shut down and is not operated anymore." And they had apparently gotten a call to cease operations right after that meeting had taken place at Fenway Park. So ultimately that individual was deported and caught up in some serious legal situation. But it was something where Eddie brought it to the attention of MLB, and it was not really addressed at all. And this is again before he joined the investigative unit in 2008. So already he was getting a sense of, here's something I'm presenting to baseball as maybe an issue or something that they need to look into, and it was not done.
They swept it under the rug
at all.
They swept it under the rug. And David Ortiz, who was mentioned in the Mitchell report as well, or he may not have been mentioned
in the Mitchell report, but he was one of the
people that was tested, and they were supposed to keep the urine specimens secret, but it got leaked out, no pun intended, that he had tested positive. But yet David Ortiz is an icon in Boston, and no one ever mentions his involvement with that. Also, speaking of deportations, Eddie was also involved in a player trafficking issue as well, correct?
Correct.
Terry,
if you want to sound off on that.
Eddie tells the inside story of how Cuban players make their way to the U.S. and into Major League Baseball. It's quite a lot of the details are very harrowing about how that works. He has a lot to say about the issues that permeate baseball on that issue and how players end up getting to become free agents coming from Cuba as refugees, basically, and the fact that they are required to gain residency through a third country and what all goes on with that whole mess. Interestingly, after our book was published, stories began to emerge, first from Yahoo and then Sports Illustrated did a very good story on the current Department of Justice investigation into this very issue, where there is a grand jury has been convened to look into baseball's role in that. I think that investigation is proceeding fairly quickly, and I imagine causing a lot of angst among a lot of people in baseball.
And there's also, which we also detail, which Eddie details in the book, was he was a government witness in a trafficking case that concluded last year and ended up with convictions of both defendants. But Eddie was called as a government witness, and it was, again, some of the same issues that he had encountered while he was an investigator for baseball. And it was just interesting that after he was terminated from the Department of Investigations, that was the next sort of chapter. And again, it was happening while he was dealing with his health issues with cancer. Again, ultimately, he testified on the stand in that case. And that involved, I don't know if that's someone that you ever came across, David, but it was an agent named Bart Hernandez. And then another defendant that was involved, like a trainer type of job. That case resulted, again, in those two convictions, but germane in many ways to what's been reported as the current federal grand jury investigating baseball.
If you're just tuning in, you're probably going, what the hell is going on? This is the Nicole Sandler Show. My husband, David Sloane, is here, and we're talking with Christian Red and Teri Thompson, two of the co-authors of a new book called Baseball Cop, The Dark Side of America's National Pastime. So David is handling most of the interview here because I know nothing about baseball other than, they hit the ball and they run around the bases.
Run out and buy this book.
So is there an investigative unit within MLB anymore, or is anybody looking into all the shady things that are going on today?
Well, it's funny you should ask that. The DOI still exists within baseball, and after they terminated Eddie and the other members in 2014, they hired a former prosecutor, federal prosecutor, to take over the unit. But we spell out in the book not only that took place, but it's interesting going back again to what Mitchell said in his original report, that this unit will be this autonomous force within baseball to look under the rug, to try and mete out wrongdoing or malfeasance. And once that started to happen, when Eddie was a part of the unit, baseball got very worried. So the interesting thing about it being gutted in 2014, 6 years after it started, is that baseball seems, at least what Eddie presents in the book, is that they didn't want the very thing that the DOI was established to do was not at all what baseball wanted to happen. So we feel like, and Eddie, again, presents this in the book, is that it was a unique experiment, one of its kind, and probably won't be seen in that kind of composition again in any professional sports league.
Well, let's be honest about it. They didn't want a cop. They wanted a janitor to sweep this under the rug and get rid of it. And one thing I can tell you, baseball certainly is not investigating at this point, is the legal use of medical marijuana by its players in order to deal with the various pain that they have to deal with. It's the same in every other sport. There is some concerns mm-hmm. about it because you've got teams in California, you've got teams in Washington, you've got teams in Colorado, all of which have recreational marijuana as well as medical marijuana, and along with the other states where there is medical marijuana as well. But they would rather give a player a shot or have him take some sort of painkillers rather than do something that is natural, not habit-forming, and very effective as well. I wish there was some way of getting through to these Neanderthals, but it just doesn't seem like they're liable to hire Jeff Sessions to run the next investigation that they have rather than go with anybody that might actually do them some good. So, Christian, Teri, thank you very much. I've enjoyed this greatly. To the audience, I hope you enjoyed
it
somewhat. It's a nice change up from all of this bullshit that Cadet Bone Spurs is making us go through at the current moment.
Christian Red and Teri Thompson. The book is called Baseball Cop, The Dark Side of America's National Pastime. I'm sorry, Teri, what are you saying?
I just wanted to say one thing about Eddie. You had mentioned the pancreatic cancer fight and the very huge problem that is. But he's a big advocate of finding a cure for pancreatic cancer.
Oh,
and is participating in a couple of events in Boston, one on November 3rd, one on November 8th, to raise awareness and fundraise for research. You know, he's been lucky, and he was, no one is a bigger advocate for that than Eddie.
Well, if you have my email address, if you have any information on those events, send them to me, and I can see to it that they'll get into the Facebook group that followed Joel Silberman in his fight, and I'll see if I can get my wife to put it on her website.
I think
too.
I can do that. All right, we're just about out of
that
time.
That would be terrific.
Christian Red and Teri Thompson, thank you so much for joining us, and to the listeners, thanks for indulging us today.
I love you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Have a great weekend, everyone.